Today we're going to take a break from the understanding discipleship series, and I figured if the Sawyer family was here, I would hear one of the twins going, "Oh man!" because she didn't get to hear what's up. So hopefully she'll come next week and pick up right where she left off. So we're going to take advantage of something. You know, those of you who know me know I'm a pretty organized guy when it comes to laying out sermons. I have 6 months planned, and sometimes in that you have to be very sensitive to the Holy Spirit and the nudging and the conviction of the Holy Spirit. All I can say is that when I try to force my will on a message, it's amazing how many roadblocks come that week. It just doesn't work out. So this week, due to the Holy Spirit voice, come on. All right, we can get through it. I promise. All right. Due to the Holy Spirit's nudging, I'm going to go on a different topic. All right? What we want to do is talk about one body of Christ. And I know you're thinking, well, Dave, you talked about this for 6 months when you were here, or at least from December through May. But we never got to this part. With that, let's begin. We must remember that all believers of Christ Jesus who believe in Him as Lord and Savior, who abide in Him in service, and who rest in Him for everlasting life in heaven are a living part of a unified body of Christ. And each and every one of us here today performs a different spiritual function within the body. You know, this shows us that the Holy Spirit equips each and every one of us with a spiritual gift or gifts, as you've seen on display today. And some of us have shared in our gifts today, especially the piano with that nice beat. So even the piano has a gift, but not a spiritual gift. Now, these gifts that we are given are to be used with purpose, as they are to build up the body of Christ. Number one, by growing and strengthening the individual part or the individual member with that gift. And number two, to encourage and strengthen the rest of the members to use theirs as well. You know, one thing this world does is try to take our differences and divide us. But it's really good at that. What we want to understand and we tend to forget is that each and every one of us that are here today and those who are not here today, we belong to each other. Man, we belong to each other. And our purpose is to minister to each other by exercising these spiritual gifts. So, and if you remember one thing from today, whether you like it or not, we need each other. Oh, do we need each other? It's very important. So why is 1 Corinthians 12, verse 26 on the screen? If one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. Well, I was telling you about the Holy Spirit and how it was convicting me to go a different direction. And even Friday morning before Tanya came in, because I promised her, I was like, I will have something for you, I promise, for the bulletin so you can print it. Even that morning, I was going to go this direction, but that verse hit me in the face and just changed everything. So what I must say is that I saw this verse come to life over the last 2 weeks. I saw this verse. Not that it was just in these 2 weeks. I've seen portions of it in other weeks in my time here. I witnessed this first as we suffered together as one body with Linda Ray and their family and close friends. You know, we suffered together as she went into the hospital and there was unknowns. You know, we went to be with the family. We prayed for them and just supported them. Second, we rejoiced together as we honored the life of Melissa at her funeral. And, you know, the love that she had for her Savior was honored, and the life that she lived because of that was honored. You know, never, and I'll say, never in my life have I been a part of or witnessed such an honoring service to both God and the person. Never in my life. You know, number one, it was hard to find a dry eye in the congregation as the Holy Spirit used every element of the service and that day to glorify Him and honor Melissa. You know, it took many different spiritual gifts to make this happen. And if it wasn't the special music and the vocal numbers by Michael, I wish he was here, because, man, he impacted me with those songs that he sang. And if it wasn't that, it was the personal testimony where Pastor Karen and a lot of you got to see her, and I got to meet her. Man, I don't think she said a word to me. She just came up and hugged me. My goodness. But what a wonderful person. It's a privilege that I got to meet her. I'll tell you what, if it wasn't her personal testimony of this window of Melissa's life, where she was encouraging and strengthening her during that time frame, and then when she exited, it was amazing how Pastor Jim and Dee Dee came into Melissa's life and was able to testify to that portion. It was just amazing to me. You know, if it wasn't the message of the plan of salvation, and some of you who were here that day saw me cry, and I'm not usually, well, yeah, I am, but all right, back, I need to refocus. They're like, Dave, whatever. All right, I'm not usually a crier at funerals because the person is deceased. That's not why I cry. I cry because it was my job to share the plan of salvation, and I experienced that love in my heart, and I just want every single person to feel that. And that's what overpowered me that day. And if it wasn't that, it was Linda on the organ. Oh my goodness, those of you who were here. She poured out her love for her God in an honoring tribute to her daughter from that organ. And I'll tell you, I wish Roy Spire was here because I've never seen that man cry. And funerals are his job. He was weeping because of that. Oh, man. You know, it wasn't just those visible gifts that were on display that day. All the spiritual gifts were on display in a day that honored Melissa, and all of us shared in that together. We see the administrative gifts where the funeral director, the employees, and the pastors organized all the elements that came together, and then that was handed off to Tanya, where she did her magic, and this amazing bulletin came together. But it wasn't just the administrative gifts. The service gifts were in full force as well, as people served the family by setting up the building and the fellowship hall and then restored it back to normal. People were pallbearers serving the family that way, taking care of the sound and the lights and ushering people in and out of the building. You know, we even had a ringing of the bell at that one moment where it was honoring to the deceased. And we even had serving the meal that followed. There's all these elements. But that's not it. We had sharing, and sharing love and encouragement, which was throughout the whole day. Oh, my goodness. I'll tell you what. I never knew everything that went into the funeral meal. Oh, my goodness. Okay? I happened to be here early that morning, and I got to experience an army of people dropping off things, every single one with a smile on their face, because they were sharing their gift with this family. And we can look at it as a casserole and as fried chicken. Oh, that's starting to make me hungry. But it's not. It's love. It's encouragement in those dishes. It's spiritual gifts being used to support that family. And we had many of us giving hugs, many of us sending cards and giving memorials in that service. So with that laid out, how did a time of suffering turn into a day of honor? I'm going to read for all of us, and you can turn if you'd like to Romans chapter 12. I'm going to begin with verse 3. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment, in accordance with the measure of faith God has given you. Just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function. So in Christ, we who are many form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have many different gifts according to the grace given us. If a man's gift is prophesying, let him use it in proportion to his faith. If it is serving, let him serve. If it's teaching, let him teach. If it is encouraging, let him encourage. If it is contributing, there we go, to the needs of others, let him give generously. If it is leadership, let him govern diligently. If it is showing mercy, let him do it cheerfully. Tanya, I needed the scripture printed out with the big words. Okay, that's enough there. Okay, so how did a time of suffering turn into a day of honor? That Romans... Yeah, man. Thank you. All right. How did this day of suffering turn into a day of honor? This is our outline that we're going to look at, is what I just read. So number one, all who shared their spiritual gifts knew their spiritual gifting and they used them accordingly. So what does it take to know our gifts and use them accordingly? First, we must understand the spiritual gifts that are found in Scripture. For those of you who would like to know those verses and want to write them down, I'll give them to you real quick. If not, hit me later and I'll share them with you. But the first one is Romans chapter 12, verses 6 through 8, which is part of what I just read. Romans 12, verses 6 through 8. The second one is 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 4 through 11 and 28 through 31. And then the third one is Ephesians chapter 4, verses 7 through 13. You know, once we understand the spiritual gifts and we read through them and try to put our minds around them, then we can pray for the Holy Spirit to reveal our spiritual gifts as we honestly evaluate ourselves. Oh my goodness, that's important. Honestly evaluate ourselves to identify the gifts within us. But it's not just about us identifying honestly. There's also trusted people in our lives that know us very well, and we can ask them for an honest evaluation too. Okay, Lori, if she asked me, Dave, what do you think one of my spiritual gifts? I would be educated enough, since I've lived with you for decades, it feels like, and enjoy as we suffer and as we honor each other and rejoice together. I would be educated to answer that question. Now, there may be people in the body that I don't know as well. If you came to me, I may not know, but I would say, let me observe. Let me observe you for a while to where we could... I would be able to give that to you. So ask trusted people in the body for their honest evaluation as well. It's very important. So why? Because the only way to honor God and others is by knowing our gifts. Not only knowing them, but growing spiritually by working in them. There's another reason why we must know them. It's because we may also dishonor God and others by misidentifying our gifts. Or forcing this misidentified gift on the body. Okay, so another way we can dishonor God is by overestimating the value of one gift over another. But to me, the real tragedy is when we underestimate the value of our gift. Okay, that's the hard part. You know, I'm going to joke a little bit because it's amazing to me whenever I see people and they're working, like say with kids, you see people working with kids and you go up to them and you say, you know what, you have a gift of working with kids. You want to be a Sunday school teacher? And their face goes pale and they just, they're out of here, right? My goodness. Or, hey, you have a gift with kids. I would love for you to be in the nursery, and gone, right? But underestimating the value of our gift is a tragedy. But the worst one to me is by not seeking or by not using them. That's the worst tragedy. So I can say in that time of suffering that turned into a day of honor, every single person was in their gifting, working it. And it was refreshing to see. The second way that a time of suffering turned into a day of honor was due to the fact that there was faithful cooperation all the way around. So all who were serving the Lord and the family that day were exercising their gift in full faith as they were growing and strengthening their faith through gaining more experience and confidence in using them. Not only that, but as they were growing and strengthening the faith of others who witnessed those gifts, it encourages the people who were seeing it to want to grow in theirs. Oh, did it ever. The other thing that they exercise their gift in proper proportion. Even though there is diversity in the spiritual gifts, and what I mean is that each and every one is different, okay? All of the gifts are equally important to the body, for the good of the church, and they should be exercised in that proper proportion and should be given proper value, which means that we should never give one or more gifts more or less value. For example, there was a lot of encouragement going on that day. There's a lot of encouragement going on that day. So let's say that encouragement is the most important gift in our body. Okay? And we go like this through encouragement, all the others suffer. So let's say preaching and teaching is the gift we're going to hold up above all others. Then encouragement suffers. And serving suffers. You see what I'm saying? They must be held up in equal balance. You know, I will say, serving others was also evident, and we could say that serving others is more important than leading others, but we who have a leadership heart know that serving others is leading others, and it was so refreshing to see so many people dropping the titles of what they hold within the church and just serving the family. Oh man, it was powerful. So imagine if the people exercising their spiritual gifts were in competition. What if we had Linda in competition with Michael and they were trying to one-up each other? Okay? What if they were jealous of each other about how well they played? And I have a quote that I would like to share that would give us a little bit more insight. Warren Wiersbe states, "We must remember that the spiritual gifts are tools to build with, not toys to fight over or weapons to fight with." And all I can say is that that did not happen on Thursday at the service or the lunch. All of the spiritual gifts were given in faithful cooperation as everyone knew their role and executed it properly. Sorry, it jumped on me. Well, this leads us to our final way that a time of suffering turns into a day of honor. All who shared their spiritual gifts that day did so lovingly. And by implying this, we must also say that we are able to share our spiritual gifts in an unloving manner, and that is possible. But to prevent this from happening, we must display the love of Jesus Christ in practice of and in sharing our spiritual gifts. Another quote by Warren Wiersbe states that the love of Christ is the circulatory system of our spiritual body. And that love of Christ binds all of us together as a spiritual body, which enables each and every part or spiritual gift to function in a healthy and harmonious way. But not only that, in an honest and humble way as we serve. The love of Christ was visible, very visible, in every aspect of the service that day, and the Holy Spirit was free to flow, and the members of the body were being used by the Holy Spirit that day as they exercised their spiritual gifts to the glory of God. This is how a day of suffering turns into a day of rejoicing, as we did it together as one body. You know, there is so much more power available to us as a spiritual body of believers. There is. And you know, I hear this a lot where people say, "I can learn about God on my own. By myself, I can do this." And I know this is weak too, but this is a lie. You can learn here about God by yourself. But the person will never fully learn about God without seeing all of His gifts working together. And this power is only available through fellowship. You know, yes, one can worship God alone. Okay, we all do in our own little way. But this is another lie if we take it without fellowship. One will never know how to fully worship God in prayer and through song and through speaking and reading until they see the spiritual gift in action. Until they see that. And again, this power is only available through fellowship with other Christian believers. We must also understand that fellowship with other believers is more than just being genuinely nice or fake nice, however we want to do it, or giving a pat on the back or a simple handshake. Powerful, Spirit-filled Christian fellowship with other believers is truly experienced when all of the spiritual gifts are on display. As we share in each other's suffering and burdens, and as we rejoice in each other's blessings from God, this is how one body of Christ can glorify God together. You know, in seeing and experiencing this over the past couple weeks, and seeing this body suffer together and rejoice together and share their spiritual gifts with one another, I'm going to ask some questions and then I'm going to deliver a statement. The first one, do you know what your spiritual gift or gifts are? Do you? If so, use them and use them for the glory of God. If not, do you want to know what they are? If so, ask yourself honestly. Ask another member honestly. Ask the Holy Spirit to reveal them to you. And I promise you, in more ways than one, it may be completely different than what you thought it was. Because I can tell you, 7 years ago, oh no, ooh, we're creeping on 9. I must be getting older. I just did the math. 9 years ago, I never thought I would be preaching. Never. I was scared to death to get up in front of people and talk. I think I was scared to death the first December 6th, the first Sunday I came here. You never know the power of what gift God has given you until you exercise it and you put yourself out there in full faith until you fail and get back up over and over again. One thing I want to say, if you don't want to know what your gift is and you don't want to use it, please remember that it's not only your loss. It's the loss of this body. We all lose. We all suffer together in that. And now for the statement. And this may sound like I'm trying to put some glory on me, and I want none, okay, or Lori. But I want to share something with you. What I saw over the past 2 weeks, not limited to those 2 weeks, I've seen it here and there since December 6th. The abundantly visible love of Christ that was displayed by all of you. The spiritual gifts being exercised by this united body of Christ as we suffer together and as we rejoice together as one family. I want to be a part of this body. I do. Diaconate Board, consider this your notice. Lori and I will be at the next meeting. And I can tell you that we want to become members of this body. And this is what this said. Whether I preach here 1 week and you hire someone else or not, we're here. This is our home now, as we've talked about. So I can't think of it any other way than sharing in this body and ministry. Oh, there it goes again. See the importance of displaying the love of Christ. See the importance of knowing and displaying the spiritual gifts with the purpose of glorifying God. If done correctly, it's contagious, and everybody will want to be a part of it. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you today in just praise, honor, and glory for the works of your hands, Lord. We praise your Holy Spirit as the Spirit has equipped each and every one of us with a special gift, a special duty to perform in this church. Lord, no matter how big and how small this world divides, your different gifts are used to unify. And Lord, we are so thankful. Lord, I'm so thankful for this church body as they came together in suffering with a family. Not only suffering with, but honoring and rejoicing with them as well. Lord, we lift this up to you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. If you would please stand, and we'll sing hymn number 433, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less. By the Spirit he gave us. Amen. You are